This is a recording by Mireille Klein from Allego. We advertised this as part of the previous webinar where we had GreenFlux and Carbon Co-ops speaking about their projects, but we are uploading it, we're uploading Mireille's talk on its own. The webinar is part of a smart charging webinar series, and the series is an activity of the SuperGen Energy Networks Hub, which is led by Newcastle, and by the Vehicle Grid Integration Group at the Alan Turing Institute. The Alan Turing Institute is the national institute in the UK for data science and artificial intelligence. And one of the objectives of the Vehicle Grid Integration Group at the Alan Turing is to apply and develop data science methods to help decarbonize transport and power infrastructure. Now, the aim of this webinar is to understand who is doing what on electric vehicle charging infrastructure, so when it is possible, we can collaborate on rolling out a fit-for-purpose, future-proof charging infrastructure. In the UK, this is particularly relevant because there are a lot of policy developments recently. For example, we just had a consultation closing where government wanted to receive feedback on what are the ingredients that make a smart charger. And the responses of the consultation are going to feed into secondary legislation on smart charging expected in 2020. And one of the components that government really wanted feedback on and emphasizing the importance is interoperability. And open communication protocols are key to facilitate and achieve this interoperability. So Mireille's work has been using open communication protocols, and we're glad to have her today so she can tell us more about her project. So Mireille, welcome, and now I'll let you share your screen.
Well, first of all, thanks you, Miriam, and I will share my screen with the presentation. I will start with, let me check where it is. Do you now see my presentation?
Yes, I could.
Good. I will first start with a short introduction about myself and about Allego before I will go into more detail about one of the projects we have regarding smart charging and our vision on smart charging. Well, first of all, I'm Mireille Klein-Koerkamp. I work for Allego. I'm the product owner of smart charging and the product owner of our EV driver app called Smooth. I work already for Allego since the start of Allego, and I'm active in the world of electric mobility for about 10 years now. And like I said, Allego, we are located in the Netherlands, and we are what is called a charge point operator, and we enable carefree charging everywhere and always. We do that from the vision that everybody wants to live in a zero emission environment, a topic that's becoming hotter and hotter with all the climate change effects that we are noticing right now. We want to create such a world by creating unlimited clean electric mobility. And our strategy currently is by providing the best charging experience for cities, companies, consumers, and drivers by realizing the right charging solutions at the right place and at the right capacity. Allego is, like I said, a charge point operator. We operate over 15,000 sockets right now. We have an uptime of over 99%. We have, this slide is not correct anymore. We have, at this moment, more than four offices in the Netherlands. That's our headquarters. We're located in Belgium, Germany, UK, Scandinavia, Portugal, France. So we're growing quite fast. We were established in 2013, so we're somewhat more than 6 years old. Currently, we have somewhat more than 250 employees, and we offer all kinds of chargers. We offer the complete range from slow chargers, home chargers, to ultra fast chargers, so the newest 350 kilowatt chargers, where the newest cars can fully charge within 15 minutes, and everything in between. Well, in the Netherlands, for instance, public charging is a large part of that, whereby people don't have their own driveways and they need to charge in the street. And the chargers are directly connected to the grid from the local grid operators. But we also do highway chargers, charging at home. Well, and we are working on a corridor to make it possible to do fast charging from the north of Europe to the south of Europe and from the east to the west. We not only focus on chargers and doing the maintenance and all the services that you need for billing each session and authorize the people who are allowed to charge your charger, but we also have our own backend. And the backend is also a product that we offer to the market without chargers. And the smart charging is an important part of that backend. The backend we developed together with Microsoft, and it's called our EV Cloud. And chargers which are talking with the open protocol OCPP can be connected to that backend, and clients can then operate the chargers on their own. So that's a bit about Allego. Oh yeah, and our main shareholder is Meridiam, French company. And we were taken over about a year ago by them. So then I come to smart charging, which is more my topic and what I work daily. Like generally known, we face a lot of challenges with the energy transition that's ongoing. On the one hand, we have the somewhat unpredictable energy sources like wind and solar. And on the other hand, we see an increase in electricity consumption as vehicles are being electrified and on average use about as much as a household. And we all want to integrate that in the existing infrastructure, the existing electricity grid, with spending as less money as possible. So do it as cost effectively as possible. Well, and smart charging could be a really good solution for that. This graph shows for an average city in the Netherlands how the energy consumption is over the day for chargers, for public chargers. And you see a clear peak in the beginning of the evening, so around 6 o'clock, whereby everybody comes home, plugs in the charger, and this is creating, together with the peak that's already there, an additional peak on the energy grid, which could be controlled, because in the end all those vehicles are parked from, let's say, 6 o'clock at night until 7 o'clock next morning, and they all start and charge immediately, where you could also postpone the charging or do other smart things with it. So that's the reason why we work on smart charging. Well, before we started the development of smart charging, we first analyzed, well, what do we see in the market, which solutions are out there, and what does it basically do, and what should we do if we develop a smart charging solution? Well, everybody knows the terms like load balancing, peak shaving, power management, local load balancing, in future even dynamic pricing, so they also take energy price into account with when you charge, use charging for energy trading purposes. But if you would make it easier or bring it back to what it in basics is, it's all about playing with power over time, influencing the amount of power being used over time. You could even see it as a smart logistics of with electrons, so making sure that the electrons are used at the right time. Well, this is another representation of the challenges ahead and how you could solve them. So the white lines graphs show the current situations, and the green shows how you could influence it and what the end result would be. Again, with a lot of different terms, basically for the same problem, playing around with power over time. Well, and why do we, as a charge point operator, think we should offer a solution in our backend for smart charging? That's basically because we are the man in the middle. So we have drivers who are parked at our chargers, and they are parked there for a certain amount of time, and that gives them the possibility to offer flexibility in their power consumption to those who need that flexibility, which are, for instance, grid operators, energy traders, but also location owners who want to have as much chargers as possible on their location, however, want to not increase their grid connection, so have limited capacity available, but want to use that to the absolute max. So we are the man with the charger in the middle between the driver offering flexibility and a party needing flexibility. And via the charger, we can influence the charging behavior of the car. And then we come to a picture which shows a bit our vision on smart charging and how our smart charging works. So in the end, we envision that smart charging is more than just combining one request for flexibility with a driver, but multiple requests for flexibility. So for instance, you have a location where there is renewable energy, or there's renewable energy close to that location. At the same location, the grid operator has a need for influencing the amount of power that's being used on the grid. And you have multiple chargers at that locations, and most likely also multiple types of users. For instance, taxi drivers, buses, but also normal cars. And that in that complete picture, all those stakeholders, actors combined should form the ideal smart charging world. It's not like it is today, of course, because now you see a lot of pilots ongoing which focus on only one of the topics. For instance, a grid operator having a problem influencing the chargers, renewable energy being produced somewhere, being aligned with the charging. But in the end, we envision that all those different stakeholders come together in one environment. So we have created a smart charging solution together with Microsoft, and that can take into account several constraints and aspects for smart charging. So it can take into account what are the specifications of the chargers, which speed, where are they located, how much power is available for a group of chargers. We can take into account specific car behavior. For instance, can it charge, can it pause or not? What is its max charging speed? What does it do on DC versus AC? We can take that into account. We can take into account location-specific aspects. So how many chargers are there? How are they connected to the power cabinet? How is the power cabinet connected to the grid? We can take into account the situation on the grid from the grid operator. And we can take into account energy production, for instance, wind or solar, and the prediction of that. And all those parameters. And then finally, sorry, before I forget, the most important parameter in according to us is the driver. So the driver can inform us about his or her needs. So I drive a car of this type and I want to leave at a certain moment. And ideally, we also know the state of charge on arrival and the required state of charge on departure. However, currently that's not really easy to get. So we made some workarounds to deal with that. But the driver, all the smart charging we do is driver-centric, So we don't want to disappoint the driver because someone else has a need for flexibility. So that's the intention on how we perform smart charging. So, and we expect in the future all these aspects to come together in our algorithm, and our algorithm then determines charging profiles for each individual charging session. Well, and as I was asked to tell you about a bit about the open protocols which we use, I also want to inform you, well, what do we use for the different parts and why is it so important to use open protocols? Well, to start, for the communication between our backend and the charger, so for smart charging, sending smart charging profiles, the exact profile on how to charge a vehicle, we use OCP 1.6 and currently, of course, also we're working on a 2.0. This is for us really important to be able to apply our solution to multiple chargers of different brands, different types, without having all kinds of proprietary protocols that we need to include. Furthermore, for getting the information from the grid operator about how much power is available, we have implemented the Open Smart Charging Protocol, also known as OSCP. In future, or if we want to go to the US, or if we will be active in the US, OpenADR is a likewise protocol, also an open protocol. But we also use OCPI. That's not yet in the current version of OCPI, but we use a version of OCPI also for those who have a system who determine their own charging profiles and want to inform us about, hey, apply this charging profile to our to a certain charger. We can use OCPI for transferring that protocol. Furthermore, that's also where we use OCPI. It's also when you have an energy management system locally, which determines how the charger should charge. Then we also can use OCPI to our backend. But in case energy management system has determined a charging profile, our algorithm, of course, will not determine a new charging profile, but our backend is able to transfer the charging profile. And then finally, and that's not open protocol, unfortunately, the driver can inform us about his or her needs via our Smooth app. We would like this to be an open protocol as well. For instance, that the car can inform us easily about its state of charge, or that it's being aligned with the calendar that a user has on his phone, solutions like that. However, currently there's no open protocol solution. Perhaps in future 15.11.8, we'll see. But for now, we use our app. And we also have an API for that app, and we want to invite other apps who can also inform us about departure times and in future about state of charge to use that API to inform us on our own chargers about what's needed. So that's basically how our smart charging solution works and our vision. And those open protocols are so important for us because that gives us and also electric mobility the possibility to make a system that's easy to use but also exchangeable. So if clients of us decide to go to a different charge point operator, that should be possible, and with open protocols that is. For us, it makes it easy because we can communicate with multiple parties in the same way. And that's, of course, reducing costs and that kind of stuff. So that's why we also are participating actively in those open protocols. So we are part of OCP. We are part of OCPP via the OCA. We're also part of OCPI, part of 15.11.8. Because it's really important for us. Well, This is another summary of the protocols we use. So like said, we have an algorithm which takes into account different input parameters. We use OSPP 1.6 currently to communicate smart charging protocols. We use OSCP for getting information on grid constraints. Currently it's OSCP 1.0. It's expected that by the end of this year, OSCP 2.0 will be implemented, and then we will accordingly act to that. And furthermore, we use an addition on OCPI for smart charging, which is expected to be released once OCPI 2.2 is also being released. But we have that interface already up and running. And then an example of a project in which we apply this algorithm. It's a project in an area in the Netherlands. It's two provinces, the provinces of Gelderland and Overijssel, where the grid operator has asked us, hey, between 5 and 9 at night, in the evening when that peak is there, please lower your power consumption for a charger. A charger has two sockets, but maximize the power usage of those two sockets in total to 7 amps per phase. So that's really low. But in case a driver really needs to charge faster because he needs to go urgently, you are allowed to take 25 amps for the complete charger. Well, we have said, okay, we will try, we will do that. And we are, chargers are currently being installed, and it will be the total of 4,500 charging sockets. So that's about 2,500, somewhat less chargers in this area where this constraint will be applied. And so you basically get 7 amps during the period from 5 till 9. But in case a driver needs more power, that's also possible between 5 and 9. And that's basically what I wanted to tell to you. And again, sorry that I was ill during the real life presentation, but I hope you still enjoy this presentation. And I should also thank EFRO and OP-OST because, and the European Union, because OP-OST is providing us the funding for this this development. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for agreeing to do this again. When you sent me the slides, I thought definitely we need to hear you talking about it. And I think the advantage of doing this is that you had more time to do this, and I have more time for questions, if that's okay.
Of course, that's okay.
Excellent. Okay, I wanted to start a bit general and then go into detail. In the UK, a large proportion of people, we take maybe London aside, have access to private parking. So they install their own residential charger. It seems that that is not the case in the Netherlands, where you still have residential chargers, but these are on street instead of private off-street chargers. Is that correct?
Yeah, the situation in the Netherlands is a bit different. So we have indeed a lot of houses where they don't have their own driveway, and they don't have their private charger. So they have to use a public charger, but which is still being used as if it was residential.
Okay, yeah, so residential on street instead of residential off street.
Yeah.
Have a number of what is the percentage in the Netherlands of people who don't have access to private charging, which emphasizes the importance of public charging in the Netherlands.
Yeah, if I recall correctly, it's about 70%. That's high.
That don't have.
Yeah, that don't have their own driveway. However, we also challenged the same problem, I think, as in the UK. If you have your own driveway and you have a residential charger connected to your home grid connection, there should also be a way or an incentive to do smart charging. And you could use the same solution like this one, for instance, but you could also incentivize homeowners, for instance, to say, okay, I want to start charging after 11 o'clock or 12 o'clock. We have a kind of a solution for that, but it's not using an algorithm, it's just postponing the charging.
Okay. Can you still do it using open protocols if you wanted to connect the charger through the energy management system at home?
Well, the problem is then taking into account what is happening in that home. Because yeah. We, as charge point operator, we don't know if you use your oven or not. Yeah. So I see a lot of challenges in there, that whether or you have a local energy management system and the grid operator is telling you for your complete home, don't use more power than this, or you have a kind of an incentive, like if you charge after 11, then you pay less per kilowatt hours for your power.
Okay.
But then you're not doing it via your, let's say, smart meter anymore.
Okay. Is it fair to say that in the Netherlands, the norm is to use open communication protocols for charging?
Yeah.
That is the norm. You won't.
Yeah, that's the norm.
How did you get to that point? In the UK, we're trying to legislate, to introduce laws to make sure we're getting there. But it seems in the Netherlands, you let the market decide, and the market decided to use open protocols?
Well, actually, I think we can be grateful in the Netherlands for a couple of people who already notified about 9 years ago when the first chargers were being installed in Amsterdam. Then, because Amsterdam was the first one of the first municipalities in the Netherlands to install public chargers at a large scale. And some people noticed that, hey, if we don't use an open protocol, if we would let the charger manufacturers do it as they want, then we cannot change after 5 years to a different supplier. Then we're always, for the coming, let's say 20 years, because at that time we all thought a charger would last for 20 years.
Yeah.
We need to stick as a municipality to that same charge point operator and charge point supplier for 20 years. And in the Netherlands, for municipalities, that's quite unfamiliar. They want to have the ability to change every 5 years.
Okay.
So they said, hey, that's strange. We should work on something like an open protocol. And also the grid operators had the same vision. So they started that incentive. And I think then somewhere along the line, that was also aligned with international incentives, and it ended up in OCA. But it was really thanks to a few people already from the start thought, hey, we want to keep that flexibility.
Okay. If I just wanted to try and make a comparison between the UK and the Netherlands, and this is just thinking out loud now, it seems the adoption of open protocols in the Netherlands, in addition to those people who championed this route, it was key that those chargers and the majority of those chargers were connected to the grid operators, were publicly accessible chargers, versus what you have in the UK, where most of these chargers are on private people's houses. Maybe that fact in the Netherlands, that they are public, they are connected directly to the grid operator, helped move things towards open protocols.
Yeah, and especially that there were funded or partly paid by municipalities.
Yes. Okay. Do you have any examples of projects in the Netherlands where you are using open protocols for privately installed chargers at home?
Well, basically it ended up in the end that also private chargers all have OCPP. It's always difficult to say it black and white, but I don't know home chargers right now who use a proprietary protocol. Yeah, there are a few, but those are really the new innovative ones.
Yeah.
But the large fleet operators, so lease companies, they all ask for chargers with OCPP. Because also they want to have the ability, they envision, hey, the charger will stay at that location from that homeowner, but it should be able to change from backend, because perhaps one backend supplier can offer the newest services.
Okay. Moving to the grid operators, you mentioned that they wanted to influence the chargers. Was that always the case? They immediately saw that you're going to have a lot of new demand. They immediately said, we need to influence this. They wanted to control the chargers, or you had to speak with them? Or how did it happen that the grid operators wanted control? And is it direct control?
No, they are not, as far as I know, aiming for direct control.
Yeah.
But they are aiming for controllability of their peak.
Okay. And this is how you can do it with things like OpenADR, for example, or OSCP. So they can say, this is our peak, try and help us reduce it, rather than direct control.
Yeah, indeed.
Okay. Moving on that point, you mentioned OCSP and OpenADR. Why OCPP was not enough?
Well, I don't know, to be honest.
Okay.
To be honest, you should ask Leonard from GreenFlex, because he was one of the founders of OSCP.
Okay.
I'm just one of the users.
Okay. This is for Leonard then. But then you mentioned also OCSP and OCPI. Why we needed both?
Well, OCPI was basically invented as a communication protocol to share information between the charge point operator and a mobility service provider. That in the Netherlands, those are the RFID card providers. So they basically share information about sessions, authorizations.
That's what, OCPI?
Yeah.
Okay.
And OCPP was basically between the charger and the backend of the charge point operator.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you still need I didn't get it. So why do you need OCPI?
So that's for the communication between a charge point operator and the card provider, the mobility service provider.
Ah, okay.
So it's a different part of communication.
Yes. And then OCSP is between the operator and the grid operator. Between the charge point office, between your back end office and the grid operator.
Yeah. Yeah, so OSCP is for backend charge point operator and grid operator. Yeah.
Got it. Okay. Do you have time for a couple more questions?
I have another 3 minutes.
Because
will be taken in a couple of minutes.
You mentioned Microsoft. Were you working with data scientists in Microsoft to develop your optimization algorithms? And by optimization algorithms, I mean here taking into account the constraint, the requirement, and determine what is the best charging profile.
Yeah, we do that together with Microsoft and their experts. Yeah. And our complete EV cloud runs on the Azure platform for Microsoft. So that's also why we decided to use their solutions and their help.
So Microsoft developed with you the optimization algorithm.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I assume they ensured that it runs fast enough, or you're not taking much more data than you need and all sorts of things.
Yeah.
So you can just easily do it, update your profile within 15 minutes.
Yeah.
And state of charge, is it key for your work, or you can do without it?
Currently we can do without it, but our optimization would be significantly better if we would have it.
Okay.
For AC, it's very difficult because the driver needs to read it out in the car, and some cars give it very clearly, some don't. So until that time, we have a workaround.
Great. Okay. Thank you so much for your time. That was really insightful and helpful. And we hope we speak again soon.
I hope so too. Thanks for the invitation.
Thank you.
I look forward to speak to you.
Of course. Bye.
Thank you. Bye. Bye-bye.